Preparing to delve in 3, 2, 1.
Hello, everybody, and welcome to Delve. We now return to our interview with Ian Price and Stephen Mattson, finally getting around to talking about Honor. Please enjoy. Tell me what is going on with Honor. What have you been working on individually or together?
I was initially brought in to write for Honor because Dominic, the lead creative for Nine Dragons and the founder over there, he had some creature/character write-ups to do for the Inhumans in the game. And so I started doing those on a project-by-project basis. And then since I'd done several of them, he invited me into the Slack that he'd set up to discuss with various people who were working on the projects with him. And I got into doing some testing on his conflict system. And then because some parts of it weren't making sense to me, I started telling him, well, here's some ideas that I have that we might be able to make work for it, and just threw together like a table of difficulties to make a certain part of the system work. And he came back and said to me, wow, you're right. This system really does need something like this. You know, this is what I usually pay for this kind of freelance development work. Would you like to just do this? Of course I said yes.
Right. For those of you playing along at home who might not know, Honor RPG is basically a martial arts inspired action game in a world more or less parallel to ours, where key styled magic is a very real thing. So it's a game where you are a heroic protagonist that has gotten tangled up in the supernatural world that underlies the whole magical martial arts world. And it's really cool. You should take a look at it. And I'm not just saying that because I'm working on it.
Right. Yeah, Dom's been on the show a few times, so.
So go back and listen to those if you need a refresher course on Honor.
Yeah.
Yep.
Yeah.
So once I started digging into it started with the conflict system and then pretty soon branched out from there because as anybody who's played or GM'd or tried to mess with the systems in an RPG knows, pretty much everything is connected to everything else. They tend to interact at the weirdest levels. And so as I was digging into it, I ended up getting into more and more things that I was going to need to change and rework to make everything work together. And at a certain point, when I had dug into creating a whole system for environmental hazards, because there wasn't anything for it yet, I had reworking most of the skill system on my plate, and I was still working through the conflict system and realizing that I would need to redo like the core action resolution, how you interpret the dice system to make all of this balance on the same playing field. I realized I might have bitten off more than I personally can chew in a reasonable amount of time. And so what I did to get Dominic on board with the idea of having Steve work with me was I took the final Inhuman write-up that I had agreed to do but hadn't gotten to because I'd started doing all this system dev work for Ao Qin, the dragon god of the South Sea. And I said, Steve, write this article based on these articles that I wrote in this style. And if Dom likes what you did on that, I'm going to suggest to him that you help me on this project. And as I suspected, Dom liked what Steve did. And so Steve started helping me.
There we are.
And there we are.
I don't have friends who do that for me.
You don't have good enough friends.
Well, the trick there is to first have good friends, and second, be the friend that does that for them. And this all just sort of ping-pongs back and forth if you surround yourself with good people. So
I surround myself with amazing people. That's why I know Dom.
There we go.
Yeah.
I have to agree that Dom is an amazing person, and that's only partly because he's paying me.
That's true. He's not paying you to say that.
Advertisement for Dominic Harry and Nine Dragons Publishing. Hey,
there's absolutely nothing wrong with being mercenary, as far as I'm concerned. You just have to be honest about it.
Yeah, exactly. Fair enough.
Steve, why don't you tell them a little bit about the parts that you have written so far in the system dev?
Okay, yes. So the parts that I've written so far is, right now I am breaking my brain against actually compiling a list of poisons, a list of effects. That's the least interesting of the stuff that I've done, and it's frustrating me because it's a lot of, we've got the list, I'm just putting it into the format and making sure the verbiage and the effects. The interesting thing there is, for that system, if you've played like D&D, you're used to the idea that, oh, certain poisons are more deadly than certain other poisons. The approach we've actually taken is kind of to flip that and to say, hey, a dose of a poison is about as roughly as dangerous to resist as a dose of any other poison, but how large an amount of a poison makes a dose is different. So like alcohol is potentially a deadly poison, but to straight up kill someone with alcohol would take like 4 kilograms of alcohol. And if they're ingesting it, okay. if you're injecting it, it's different, but then it's less of a poison and more of an attack. On the other hand, some more traditional poison like cyanide is going to take a matter of 300 milligrams to have a potentially deadly effect, and then like doubling down on a dose makes that different. So they're both a difficulty one dose, but one is much less dangerous simply because you need so much more of it. So that's the most interesting thing that's being done with that so far. What I'm really excited about is damage and chases. And those are both things I've had my fingers really deep in.
Specifically, it's the healing damage system that Steve wrote.
Right. The idea behind the healing damage system kind of goes back to the question that you mentioned all the way back when we were warming up for this. Like, why do we even have hit points?
Right.
And it starts from that position. It's like, okay, well, in the first edition, we have functionally a couple of different hit point tracks, and there's nothing interesting about them. They're a track. They track your damage as they go down. You're getting more hurt? If you take significant enough amount of damage, you're dazed. And it's like that's fine, but that doesn't really. They don't really matter. It's just like kind of like in D&D. If you have one or more hit points, you're fine. If you have zero or less hit points, you're not fine, and nothing else really matters. So the idea to make things interesting was, let's do away with the idea of hit points. Let's turn everything into injuries, or since it's not just physical, it can be mental or emotional or social even. Let's turn these into harms. And when harm is inflicted, harms penalize your character when they're trying to do things. Because I don't know if you've ever broken an arm, while that's healing, you don't have an easy time doing anything. But the pain also makes it hard to concentrate, unless you're taking drugs for the pain, which make it hard to concentrate. If you're just walking down the street, you're not using your arms, but you move your arm wrong and, ow, that hurts. That reminds me I'm injured. You're disadvantaged in social situations unless you're really good at spinning a cool story about the cast on your arm, because the first thing people notice is, oh, your arm, and that totally changes the social situation. Any injury kind of ripples over to affect everything. But this also makes the players actually pay attention to, what hurt me? What am I treating? It's not just, oh, I'm vaguely badly banged up. It's, oh, I've taken this type of damage. I'm tracking the consequences directly. And suddenly that makes them matter so much more.
One of the core things that Dom was trying to accomplish, and ended up really appreciating the direction that Steve and I have gone with it, he wanted Honor to be a game in which conflict is, as Steve briefly mentioned, on multiple levels, not just physical combat. So we have been developing this system that has conflict on the physical, mental, key and emotional, and coolness social levels. So when you're aggressing against somebody, you could be doing a physical attack, you could be making a mental argument, you could be projecting your key at them to influence their emotions and the state of their key, or you could be posturing and swaggering and just being awesome. And all of these things have the potential to harm or to gain some other conflict advantage over people. That's why we created this generalized harm system, so that we could have the effect of somebody dissing you so hard that you remember it for the rest of your life, have some kind of system mechanics equivalency to somebody stabbing you in the heart.
Mm-hmm. The first thing that I did was actually the chase rules. And if you've ever DM'd a game like, again, Dungeons and Dragons, but even Shadowrun, most of the time, if you have a chase situation going on, it really comes down to who rolled higher on initiative, who has the fastest move. Okay, I block the door. All right, we're done here. You either go into traditional combat, but it's not tense. There's nothing really resembling the chase sequences in movies. It's just, well, can I reach him this turn? No, he can move faster and goes first. Well, I guess he gets away. Or, well, I guess we catch them. It's very transactional. So,
and often very binary, which is the tension leaks out.
So the idea here is that if you watch movies, if you watch TV shows, the chase scene is this very back and forth. It doesn't actually have much to do with who's faster, so much it has to do with interacting with the environment, herding people into areas, avoiding or hitting the food cart, etc. The drama comes from the chase itself, not from the, well, who moves first on the battle map. And so I did a little re-envisioning, and it's not really a traditional move around on the map type of thing anymore. Distance specifically doesn't even matter. It's now envisioned as a tug of war. And your goal is to get the resolution to fully favor your side. Like the diagram we use is basically a number line, and in the middle is zero. It's perfectly in balance. No side has an advantage. And if it tips to one direction, now the chasers have an advantage. Tips the other direction, the person being chased has an advantage. And as the rounds go through, everyone has a chance to try to do their thing. You describe, what am I doing in this chase? I'm being chased. Well, I'm going to run down an alley. I'm going to scale the fence at the end of the alley. I roll, and if I succeed at the roll, I tip the balance further in favor of me. Oh yeah, you scramble over the fence, and your pursuers are going to have to contend with this obstacle, and so it's now in favor of you getting away, you achieving your goal. If I fail at that roll, I actually tip the balance further in the other direction. I'm trying to scale the fence. I failed at the roll to scale the fence. I'm now at a disadvantage because here I am standing at the foot of this fence and they're closing in. And now my pursuers have the advantage. And so everyone has a chance to tip the scale one way or the other on their action. And it's a tug of war now instead of a just who gets to the finish line first and why can't we pursue them past the finish line, GM? I don't understand. Why do we have to stop here? It's very narrative.
I think I vaguely remember a while back, I was actually talking to Dom about chase mechanics, more narrative than mechanical. So I'm glad to see it's gone in that direction.
I posted a visual example of the number line track that Steve was talking about in your tabletop design chat channel.
Oh, hello. There's the Taijitu there.
Yep, there it is.
And that goes into an interesting thing where we have been making Dom very happy, because making yin and yang and the elemental flavors of ki important in the mechanics of the system is something that he's always wanted to do more with, and we've come up with some really interesting ways to integrate that.
I like the idea of like a wound system, like that I can be dissed so hard that it feels like a knife through the heart, because that's kind of like Alex and me on this show. I feel like it's a knife through the heart every time I talk. He insists.
Oh, introverts unite.
Yeah.
Separately, of course.
Of course. With 6 or more feet between us.
Yeah, that's the best way to do it, too.
Raise our voices quietly in a controlled manner.
With as little as possible drawing attention to ourselves.
Please. Yeah, that's where I am, too. So
one of those things with the hit points or the wounds and everything that we were talking about with the health and everything. I know, like, Warhammer, for instance, the Fantasy Flight games they did with the Warhammer system, you can be injured, you get your arms taken off, and it's really in depth with it. Like you can get the, especially their critical hit tables.
Ooh. Oh gosh, those are glorious critical hit tables.
They're amazing, and it's like you just
they're also terrifying.
You're like, well, my arm just blew off, put me in a shock, and vaporized all the blood in that side of my body.
How did he just punch out all of my blood?
So like, one of the things that I just finished writing was the consequences of conflict portion of the new finished rewrite of that. And so to give an example of how that works in honor, when you take harm, you're going to be comparing how much harm you took to what may or may not get renamed, but what I'm currently calling the ouch line. This is a number that tells you if you take an instance of harm that is equal or less than this, then it's minor. But if you take an instance of harm that is more than this, it is major. So it's the difference between a graze and a wound for a physical harm, or it's the difference between an insult and an outrage for a coolness harm.
So it's like a threshold.
Yeah, exactly.
Because like with like the graze and wound, for example, they both might have even drawn blood, but the graze is going to be, it's going to bug you for a day or two while it heals up, but the wound is probably going to require medical attention.
Exactly. And there are two key differences between something that is below and above that threshold. If you have a minor harm, so it was equal to or less than your ouch threshold, you are not ever going to suffer complications from that harm. It's going to be bad for you while you have it, but eventually it will go away.
In this game is simulated by the fact that you're at a penalty because of the minor wound, and then you go rooting around in the garbage and you're facing the garbage hazard, which could infect you, and you're already at a resistance penalty because you're wounded. So it's like, the by itself, the small cut will never get complications, but it can disadvantage you in future situations before it's healed up.
Exactly. And then as your wounds and such mount, there's also a shock threshold for each of the four categories of aspect: the physical, mental, emotional, and coolness. And if your total harm in that category equals or exceeds your shock threshold, you start having the possibility that you'll be incapacitated. And if while you are incapacitated, you suffer any complications, that's when your character is eliminated by the harm. So you might die, or you might just be the equivalent of dead, but you're not technically dead. You're just completely out of the story.
It sounds like there's a lot of moving parts going on in this particular case, and there kind of are, but the important part is all the complexity is front-loaded. It all happens before you start rolling the dice. So everything you need to know when you start rolling the dice is, well, I need to roll this many dice under this number, let's go. So it avoids one of the issues that a lot of people do run into with like D&D late 3.5, especially, or Pathfinder. Wait, hang on, I forgot these modifiers. Well, who do I qualify for this one? You know all of this before you roll the dice, so you don't have to delay while you look up, how does this system work?
And one of the great things about honor, like one of the unique things about honor that people who have listened to previous instances of this podcast where Dom has been on will probably know, is that your difficulty tells you how many dice you're going to roll. And that made defining this concept of harm as a penalty really easy for us, because each level of harm is another die that you roll in the honor system. That's the core mechanic of honor, where you roll a number of dice, and the higher the number of dice you roll, the harder it is to roll under the number that you're trying to hit, which is your aspect. So more dice, it's harder. Well, if you get hurt, you roll more dice equal to how much more hurt you were.
Now, when I'm playing honor and I'm not quite dead, but I'm kind of dead, and I'm in a mall.
When I'm not dead yet.
No, I'm in the shopping mall and I'm kind of dead. Do I have to worry about someone coming along on a bike and whacking me on the head with a baseball bat?
quite a bit.
Okay.
You don't have to worry about someone randomly coming along on a bike and randomly whacking you on the head unless the GM is playing that way. As an aside, one of the things that I see a lot in the narrative versus simulationist debate, which I have many, many thoughts on, is the whole, you know, my player character just got randomly one-shotted by a goblin who rolled a lucky crit. Where's the drama in that? And we address that idea in the conflict system of honor by saying, well, the drama is that it happened. The drama is that this fight was important enough to roll out. And yeah, you got overwhelmed. And that's the drama. The drama is that this lowly goblin was actually able to do this. It's not some random anticlimactic thing. It's wait, what just happened? Oh my gosh. So yeah, if you're seriously wounded and you're trying to crawl to safety and no one's backing you up, yeah, you do have to worry an awful lot about one of your adversaries coming up and saying, oh, I see a hero is wounded. I had best not take any chances.
System-wise, if you are incapacitated by a certain type of harm, and then somebody does more of that type of harm to you, then that's an automatic elimination.
It's also a deliberate choice by the game runner. And that's the important thing. It's not just a random thing that'll come out of left field. It's the storyteller, the teller, looks at it and says, okay, this character is injured. The villain decides that it's worth potentially pissing off the rest of the characters who will see I've just eliminated his friends. It's worth taking my mind off the fight to chase the injured person who's already no threat and eliminate the injured person. So there's a built-in disadvantage because to go finish someone off, you have to stop fighting the people you're fighting. It's very much like a real-time tactical game. If I turn around to say, oh, you've got one wound left and can't really hurt me, but these other guys have full health bars and can really hurt me, maybe I should just ignore the small threat.
Right.
So there's a narrative balance of I've just removed the character's attention from the fight to do this. There's the storytelling tension. And so it's something that the character has to be worried about, but it's something that really plays into the drama of the game because it's never accidental. It's always very intentional.
It's also something that we cribbed from 7th C. In 7th C, when you take dramatic wounds, you can go down because of them, but you won't die unless you've gone down and a villain takes an action to take you out. That is similar here in the system that we're making for honor. You can go down because of an attack that you take, whether it be a physical or a mental attack, but you won't die from one attack roll, no matter how badly it went for you. You will only die if either A, you fail to recover from that wound later because you didn't get adequate care, or B, because somebody specifically came up to you and the storyteller said, this enemy was so upset with you or is just so evil that they are finishing off your downed comrade.
I had one question before it gets a little too late in the day for the two of you. And it's one that Dom had actually inquired about. He was interested in the idea of people coming into a game that's already existing and trying to develop it more. When you are coming into a game that is already in existence, how are you able to work on it and still keep the game soul, as he put it, intact?
The two most important questions when coming on to stick your fingers into someone else's pie, if I can get a little weird with my metaphors there, are basically, why is this here? And what is the goal of the developer? And Dom is excellent to work with as a developer because his writing style is clear enough that I can look at it and see, oh, this is what he's getting at. This is what he's going for. This is what's important to him. And then when I have pinged back to him and said, okay, so here is my stab at this. Is this in line with what you've thought? He's like, yes, this is exactly what's in line with what I've thought. So the first is what's the developer going for? What is the mood? What is important to them? You want to work around that. And that leads to the second question of why. It's to look at chase scenes and healing damage. and healing damage actually had a fairly significant thing going on there, because if it's just healing damage off of a number line, it's perfunctory. You've got to work out times. So why is it important that we need rules to heal damage? And that led to a rework of how the wound system worked, because what the developer wanted was for all of this to be dramatic, for all of this to be important. And so why do we need this to make it line up with the original vision?
I would definitely agree with everything Steve said. So rather than adding anything on the philosophy that shapes it, because Steve has encompassed that pretty excellently with those two questions, mm-hmm. I am going to tell the brief story of how we got to this point. For me, when I was doing the Inhuman write-ups at the start of working with Dom on the new edition of Honor, that gave me a chance to sink my teeth and my writing fingers into the setting and the character of the world of Pangu and the spaces between and what Honor is. And through the discussions I had with Dominic about that, I had already gotten to know the direction of his thinking fairly well. So when it came time that he was starting to talk to me about doing the system side of it and redeveloping the system with him, I already had a pretty decent idea of his desires and directions. So I knew how to ask him some good questions and get right to the heart of, okay, what are your design objectives for this aspect and this aspect? And because I had actually had a copy of the previous edition of Honor to reference, because I'd helped playtest it, and so he'd given me one very kindly back several years ago when he'd first made it.
The first edition? The one I have sitting behind me over here?
Yeah, the paperback one that you probably have there.
Yeah.
So I had that to reference, and looking at his new document and talking to him about what he felt his design objectives were, it gave me a really clear picture based on wanting exactly the information Steve was talking about and having worked with him for a while already, so that I was able to impose my ideas on things. But since I was pushing my ideas towards the same objectives, it just came out in a way that Dominic has consistently been saying, wow, this is exactly like what I thought I wanted, but in a way I would never have thought of.
There's two more things that crystallized while Ian was talking. And the first is very closely related to what he finished with. And that is to remember, it's humility. If you're coming on board on someone else's project, no matter how excited and how confident you are in your own stuff, especially if it's like a revised edition or a second edition like we're doing with Honor, there is very important to have the humility in yourself to constantly remember, hey, we're not making our own grand game. However much we want to add to it, we're pushing towards the same goal, and that goal is to better realize the core creator's vision.
Putting a note real quick before you get to the second thing on that, one of the things that helped is that Dominic has been, in his own words, not precious about things. So the fact that he also has that humility, and so we are able to neither side of this equation have ego getting in the way has been helpful.
Man, I could go on a point about that, but I won't right now.
Oh, good gravy. I think we're all probably going to be on the same page, because the older I get, the more I realize that people just... Can we just, you know, respect each other as individuals and creatives and work together instead of posturing and beating our chests? That would be great.
It'd be lovely.
The second thing is kind of a riff off of that, and it's basically in addition to humility, it's the respect, and it's both respect of the original mechanics and respect of the people you're working with. Even if it's asynchronous, we're in Central American time zone, and Dom is off in Hong Kong, and I have never real time spoken to Dom, and I kind of regret that. But it's a team effort, and so everything that I put forward is not me saying this is done. It's me saying, okay, take a look at this. I'm done with this. What needs to be changed? Are we ready to go ahead? If Dom were to say no, it's not an attack on me. He respects me enough to say, no, this isn't what I want. If I say, ooh, this doesn't work, I'm not attacking something. I'm saying, well, this doesn't really sync up. And that also goes with respect to the game mechanics. It's like, no matter what I thought of it, whether the core honor dice mechanic, I happen to be a huge fan of it, but even if I wasn't, there's this basic respect for the core system. It's like, no, I'm being brought on to work with this. I'm not touching the core system. I'm building around it because it's the foundation that I've specifically been brought on to work with. Humility and respect are like the two last parts that make it possible to actually do meaningful work on someone else's project.
Like, I have the first edition copy, and I've read it, and I looked over it, and I discussed some of the stuff with Dom a while back too about his concerns and what he wants to try and do. So the fact he has people working on it and that seem to be doing a good job in the direction it's going is really, really pleasant to me.
I'll just talk a little bit about our relationship with Dominic there. It has been a beautiful working relationship because he is very clear, like Steve said earlier, he is very clear in expressing the things that he wants and the things that he's trying to do. And he is very open to talking about them. And I'd have to say that, like, there's no sacred cows when dealing with Dom. Mm. There's only objectives and how do we achieve those. So he wasn't even saying that we have to stick to the resolution mechanic that the game has. He just expressed his objective of he wanted to maintain the unique and quirky character that Honor has as a game system. And I was the one who came back and said to him, no, I do not want to do away with the Honor dice. Those are great. I love them. And we're going to keep that and we're going to build from there.
If you listen to community conversations, there's this huge back and forth between rules light, rules heavy, rules light, rules heavy, and people like to draw battle lines. And I'm sitting here saying I like both of them when they're executed well and hate both of them when they're executed poorly. And there's a right system for the right feeling. So one of my first growing interactions with Dom was I sent in a draft. I believe this was the draft for the healing rules, and it was this quantum step forward in complexity from the previous version. And there's all these possible rules and interactions and all these weird numbers that didn't exist before. And he comes back and he says, well, I'm concerned. This sounds like there's an awful lot going on. And the first thought going through my head was, oh crap, I have upset the sacred cow. I have input a mechanical complexity into a system light game. So I shot back my defense of it, and I said a lot of things. I said stuff like, well, I feel like this isn't too mechanically complex because the characters aren't going to be engaging with it all the time, and I feel like some complexity is actually a very good thing because the more effort you put into a thing, the more important the players will think it is and feel it is. And once I'd gotten done explaining myself, Dom just replies with, cool, that's all I needed to know. You've thought this through. We're going to go ahead with it. It's like, wait, what? I thought I'd messed up here.
Yeah, and that's something that we've been learning with the process is that Dominic is a very methodical, step-by-step thinker. He wants to suss out that thought behind what he's given and understand the underpinnings as well as what's on the surface. And that actually is part of what's made him a real joy to work with. Speaking of mechanical right-sizing, that gets to one of the interesting things that we're getting to do here. One of the things that I've reworked already is while the core resolution system is remaining, you roll a number of honor dice trying to get under your statistic. One of the things that I reworked is how you interpret those results to give it three different, like, complexity levels that you can address that role with, so that you can address it as a binary success failure for just resolving quick actions, so that you can look at how much you succeeded or failed, or so that you can look at it in a very detailed, not only how much did you succeed or fail, but what effect do like the tools you were using and the environment and what you were trying to affect with that role have on did you have enough effect? And that was necessary so that I could take that and apply that to the conflict rules, so that we can have a simple, quick version of the conflict rules and also a fully in-depth version of the conflict rules. Because that was one of the design goals from the start, was to be able to say, here's your conflict rules, but if you just want to fight a couple of nameless thugs, or you have new players in the game, you can use the quick rules. Or if you're having a really important battle where everything that the PCs can bring to the table should matter and you want to really get into the nitty-gritty, here's the rules that give you that mechanical depth with some complexity that you might not always need.
But they all center around, they don't use different mechanics, they all center around grab the dice based on the difficulty, roll them, add them up. Did you roll under your stat for target, your aspect for target number? If yes, then the roll is on some level of success. If no, the roll is on some level of failure. And so it's just right. All levels of interpretation.
I see. Yeah, but the idea that you have quick rules makes it feel like, for pacing, especially when you have faster actions where you're trying to get right into it, the pacing is better in those faster moments. Because I don't have to go through that longer.
And so you can use them, and probably will. The intent is that you will use them interchangeably in the same game session.
Yeah, it's very much designed to be a flow sort of thing. A thing that you, as a storyteller, will be able to go by feel. Go by, do I feel that I need to do a full combat order role and get people into an initiative order and play this out by the numbers? Or can we just resolve this in a couple quick rolls? Or do we need to do something in between? We'll resolve the first bit in some quick rolls, and then we'll get into a few serious rounds of conflict, and then we'll go back to quick rolls. And you'll be able to feel it out and go moment by moment.
It's an interesting idea. I don't know, Alex, if you've seen that before or not, or if this is unique, something that you've...
Not exactly in that way, anyways. Every game is unique in their own way, Nathan. So
everything is special in its own way. I get that. We're all special in that way.
I'd have to say that one game I could point to as an influence on this specific aspect. Have you heard of a game by Robin Laws called Edge of Midnight?
I have not.
So Edge of Midnight specifically is a odd sort of film noir inspired setting that has its own quasi-supernatural backstory to it. But the most important thing about the system that inspired me in this system creation is the way that Robin went into describing how the stakes that you're rolling for get set as sort of a negotiation between the player and the GM, and the fact that what you are going to get for success and failure is something that you establish before the roll, and then after the roll, you narrate what actually happened.
That's intriguing.
That's what you say?
Well, sometimes is just a placeholder for, I have a lot to take in here. I don't know what to say, but I want to acknowledge that I heard it.
My general state of being is I have a lot to take in. I have to think about these things in more detail.
I think that's totally fair.
Okay, good. Alex, did you have something more than that you wanted to talk?
I guess you're right.
You know, that's the start of all game design, right? You say, Yeah, exactly. Oh, how long have you actually both been working on Honor at this point?
Well, for me, less than a month at this point, okay. Really batting around ideas with Ian unofficially as kind of serving as his rubber duck pretty much since he started working on it. But for okay. me personally, hands-on, really less than a month. I could get the exact dates, but I've only seriously been crunching it for several weeks to a month now.
So the right. first thing Dom paid me for was a sort of a GM advice essay that was going to go into the Storyteller Companion part of the new edition. That was back in May. And then I think it was late June when he started having the Inhuman write-ups that he wanted people to do, and I started taking on those projects. And so it's been since then that I've been continuously working in the system.
Oh, okay. My brain went all wonky. I guess that can happen to me. I got lost in a mall. I forgot what I was doing.
It's that mall again.
It's that damn mall. I got lost in a mall. And I went
sometimes it feels like all of us have a mall in our heads that we can't escape.
Yeah, absolutely. I'm back in George Romero territory. I can't get out of this damn mall. There are actually malls in honor, aren't there? Or at least there could be.
There had better be. I can't imagine a world that has largely the same developers, but magic is real, not having some sort of shrine to the consumer god, possibly inhabited by actual consumer gods. Oh. So I could actually see that shopping malls might be even more prominent.
Yeah, probably not openly inhabited by the consumer gods, because one of the conceits of honor, as people who are familiar with it might know, is that only the people who are awakened to Ki are aware of quite how real and literal the effects of Ki and magic are mm-hmm. in the world. But it's definitely there. So yeah, malls, okay. they exist.
Okay.
And you probably can get trapped in them and have to replay things over.
It's a groundhog mall.
It's a groundhog mall.
especially if you piss off the wrong god or demon that might have dominion in that mall.
And now I know if Dom approaches me to write an introductory adventure for Honor, I am right back to Groundhog Day Mall.
Right back to the mall.
And people who know me are going to understand and say, let Steve write that.
So now the thing, so if you had a mall and it was in this world, it might look like a regular mall unless you have Ki. And then there might be special places that you could locate by, I'm going to just say, a kiosk where you could, that would have like magic and potions. Yeah, there you go. We're already writing it. There's a kiosk. It doesn't look like anything unless you are Ki sensitive.
Well, have you ever worked in a shopping mall out of curiosity?
I've yes. worked in retail, but not a shopping mall.
Yes. Okay. So yeah. if you've worked in a shopping mall, then you know that it's not really an iceberg, where it's not like you only see 10% and the rest is on the surface. But the Disneyland effect is in full force. There's at least half the mall that nobody ever sees, between administration and maintenance right. and all of that. There's always behind the scenes. Mm-hmm. So you see some of this in Dead Rising, like especially the original Dead Rising. All the maintenance access you do to avoid the zombies. Mm-hmm. But it's entirely reasonable to say, well, hey, the Taoist alchemist shop is actually in the back of the Yankee Candle Company, because there's yes. the Yankee Candle storage room. Right. And if you have Keysight, or if you're otherwise tuned into the hidden world between, then right. you can either notice or talk to the right people in the Yankee Candle Company, and they'll take you into the storeroom. And then there's this hidden wall. And if you're attuned, you can walk through it. And now you're in the alchemy shop, and all the scents from the alchemy are hidden by the weird scented wax that is up front, because they're just overwhelmed. Well, that's the perfect cover, isn't it?
And then yes. you've got the next level beyond that, because not only do you have the slightly hidden world for those who are awakened to Ki and know that there are charmed ones and demons and sorcery out there, But then you have the spaces between where you can slip into other worlds that might be alternate versions of Earth, or they might be places more like heaven and hell and other magical worlds.
I do like the idea that I would access magical worlds through like a Yankee Candle.
It's the Bed Bath and Beyond, Nathan. Get it right.
It's the Bed Bath and Beyond.
The Bed Bath and really far beyond.
And it's all about it's really all about a combination of, on the one hand, you want a combination of symbolism and practicality and use what's there. On the other hand, sometimes you just want to throw a complete curveball to your players, and so shocking them with something really weird and wacky. So you want to walk the tightrope between, oh, that actually makes sense, and wait, what? Where did that come from?
Well, I'm pretty sure if you gave them this scenario, that, wait, where did that come from, reaction would be in full force.
And then it would be in even greater force next week when you gave them the scenario again.
What? Okay, you're back.
The dream is to constantly be cycling between them. So it starts with like, oh, wait, this is weird. Where did it come from? And then they become accustomed to it. It's like, oh, now that makes sense. And then shortly thereafter, wait a minute, this doesn't make sense. Oh, no, that makes sense. And just constantly be building and growing on what you've established before. Organic world building, organic growing, getting people accustomed to it, but still being able to trot out the weirdness that even after your players have memorized the monster manual, you can still throw them for a loop. Either because, on the one hand, wait a minute, this is not a monster from the monster manual, or because, hang on, beholders don't fit in my medicine cabinets. And, very small beholders, maybe, but this is somehow a full-size beholder in the medicine cabinet that, oh god, it's disintegrated.
Open up and disintegrated.
Make a save! So the end goal is to actually constantly be invoking both of them on a fun level.
Always on a fun level. That's the only level I know.
Exactly.
Yeah. And for games, that's perfect.
Right? It's like games can be about a lot. Some of my best gaming experiences have not been what I would describe as fun at the time. But when we were done, it was like, oh my gosh, that was so good. I can't believe what we did. It was grueling, but we were so invested. So fun gets a little bit wibbly wobbly when you look at it, because it's not always, oh, we're just laughing and having a grand old time. Sometimes it's like, this isn't fun at all. I'm terrified. I'm stressed. I'm having the time of my life.
Yeah. Alex, have you ever been trapped in a mall before?
Unfortunately, yes.
Oh, that's
just not for eternity.
Oh, not for eternity. And probably not with the help of a kiosk.
No.
Okay, great. I want to thank Ian and Steven for coming on the show. Thank you both for being here.
Oh, thank you for having us.
It was a pleasure.
Yeah.
Thanks for never leaving. Ever.
Yeah.
You're stuck here.
We got stuck in this mall. And it's impossible.
Is this the version with the tank in the department store? Because I really like
it. Oh, yeah. Absolutely.
Is there at least a teriyaki place?
Yes. There's
maybe. There's a sushi place.
Sushi.
There's one sushi place, and then there's a sushi place across from the other sushi place. So that's just...
This isn't such a bad mall to be stuck in.
No, okay. Absolutely not. It refreshes every day, so you know that your sushi is always fresh. So if anyone was looking to get in touch with you or find you online somewhere, where could they find you? Ian, I'll start with you.
If they wanted to get in touch, they could find my games at kitsunecg.com for Kitsune, Foxes, and Fools. And pretty soon we will have the new baddecisionscg.com working. It's mostly set up right now, but it doesn't actually do some of the things that it's supposed to do, because we're getting it set up to collect people's email addresses so that we can tell them when the app is finished. And they can find me on Twitter at IANWAPRICE.
That's easy enough to remember.
Yep, it's just my name, Ian W. A. Price.
And Steven, where could they find your work and the contact information?
At the moment, I am mostly online in two places. I am on Twitter at @JazzElves, JAZZELVES. There is a story behind that. It's not a long one. It was automatically suggested back in the AOL days, and I've been stuck with it ever since. I also stream on Twitch. It is mostly video games, but I'm about to have a tech upgrade so that I'll be streaming some D&D and tactical miniature painting and building and just talking about all sorts of stuff there. So if you want to come hang out, watch me be the very best at playing games that no one's ever heard of and actually fail pretty miserably. I am also Jazz Elves on Twitch TV. I'm streaming about 3 to 4 times a week. That is usually on Mondays, Thursdays, and Saturdays. And I'd love to see you folks there.
Alex, if folks wanted to find out more about Delvey things, where could they go?
You can find more about Delve out at delvepodcast.com.
Well, it's delvecast.com, but good try.
See, this is why we can't have nice things.
And of course, you can find more about Honor at Nine Dragons. Crap, what was their website?
Nine Dragons RPG? Pub. Nine with a nine.
Yeah, you always
we'll put
have
a link
remember,
in the description of the show.
You always have to remember that it's nine with a nine.
Right, it's Nine Dragons RPG, but the G in Dragons is a nine.
Right, Nine Draninans RPG.
Make sure to look for the link in the description.
Absolutely.
Because otherwise you're probably going to get confused. When you go on delvecast.com, Alex, you can find everything that we do over there. You can also find our Patreon tab. And if you are a patron, boy, you're getting a long episode for the patron version. You enjoy this. It's
for
like,
$1, over it, 3 hours worth of content.
Yeah, just a whole dollar. You'll get 3 hours of this conversation. And hey, there's a lot of talk about bagpipes. You know you want that. thank you to our shiny level patrons. Dom Perry. Hey, we talked about him here on the show. And Bonnie Ainsworth. You can also find us on a whole bunch of different podcast apps, and if you happen to be using any of them, please rate and review and subscribe. We always enjoy that. We get stars, just like how a fox has more tails, and that's good. More stars brings us closer to podcast heaven, so...
Where we die and we do audio
things
forever?
Yeah, well, that was a given anyway. We keep going back to the mall, Alex.
Oh, God.
And for anyone who is following on Twitter, in addition to Ian and Steven, you can find us. I am at Citanium.
I am at EXP Limited, and you can find the show at Delve Podcast.
And so then you can keep up on all the Delvey things, the Delviest Delves, just kind of like the Elfiest Elves or the Jazziest Elves, but or Jazz.
There is that.
Jazz Delves. See, there's the name of the...
Thanks for delving deep into our work.
Yes.
Dun, dun, dun.
There, that is good. That's brand synergy right there. That's
the entire really reason it's a brand.
Good point, Alex. Good point. You can pat yourself on the back. You did a good job. I again, just want to thank Ian Price and Stephen Mattson for being on the show. It's been an absolute pleasure.
Likewise. Thank you again for having us.
Maybe we'll be back with Dom next time.
For Possibly. 6 hours worth of conversation.
That we might have to do as like maybe a stream when we get everybody together and we can just sit down and talk or something like that. Because otherwise, I don't know how I'm going to record that long and edit it together. Carefully.
It'll be a live stream. We'll do it. It'll be fine.
Yeah. Okay, good. Because that would be fun to edit. 6 hours of science. Jesus. Okay. So thank you from everyone here at Delve. Thank you for joining us, and we will see you next time. Goodbye.
Bye-bye.
Bye. Well, you see, for my ancestors, bagpipes are a weapon of war, and they are there to inform you that there's about 2,000 Scotsmen coming over the hill with them.
Oh, okay. See, that makes bagpipes seem much more intimidating than normally. Associate with him with.
There was that time that John Paul Jones was sailing around the coast of England and Scotland, and my ancestor Jamie MacLeod scared him off while dead. Because you see, John Paul Jones, the famous American privateer, he saw this huge gathering of armed Scotsmen on the beach and assumed that they had assembled to see him off their coast, and so he sailed away. It was actually Jamie MacLeod's funeral.
Oh.
This is a matter of historical record, yes.
Yes.